C of Module 2, the topic asymptotic notations. This is the main topic of this module. And we did preparation in part A, part B. So basically we slowly prepare for this main part, asymptotic notations, pretty abstract. C.1, introduction to asymptotic notations. Yeah. All right. Let us consider the limits of two growth functions. Last time I did one example, one simple example. All right. But now let us consider the general case. We consider two growth functions. When we use the limit to compare two growth functions, we have these cases. For the results, for the possible results of the limit, how many possible results do we have? So here I list all the possible cases. Yeah. There are four cases. First, the first case, the limit equals zero. Second case, limit equals a non-zero constant, C. Non-zero constant. All right, yeah. But for this class, we assume it's positive constant. Yeah. All right. The third one, infinity. The last one, other. So if it is not any of the above three cases, there is remaining one, yeah. Usually people call does not exist. The limit does not exist. Yeah. That's the last case. And we also need to consider this case. The limit does not exist. Because in that case, we need to compare two growth functions. So we will talk about that later. Yeah. All right. Now let's look at these cases one by one. One, two, three, four, one by one. All right. The first case, when f of n over g of n, when n goes to infinity, the limit equals zero. What conclusion can we get? What is the conclusion when we compare? Yeah. Comparison conclusion can we get? Which function increases faster? So you can see denominator function, right? Increases faster, that means its value increases larger and overcome easily the numerator value, right? So based on that observation, we can say the order of growth of f function is less than order of growth of g function. Here we use a concept called order of growth. Order of growth. Yeah. But this concept, order of growth, how to precisely describe it, right? Order of growth. So here, I think the usual way to describe it, for example, n squared, when we look at the n squared function, the order of growth, that square number, all right? Yeah, that's the order of growth. Yeah. But when we have n log n, So this time, it's hard to use one number to represent it, right? How do you use one number to represent it? So sometimes when you describe, I saw a question, all right. Why is f of n's growth less? Yeah, all right, good question. Yeah, so let me try to elaborate. Yeah, try to elaborate the question. Why f function's growth less than g function? It is because it is the numerator denominator. It is because the limit equals zero. The limit equals zero. Limit equals zero, that means for the long run, f value increases slower than g value. G value increases much, much faster, okay? And then their ratio becomes smaller and smaller, and eventually it becomes zero. So now it's not a position. Yeah, when you look at the numerator denominator, you also need to look at the limit result. Limit is zero, C, infinity, then your conclusion will be different. Yeah, all right. So here, I just explained when we talk about order of growth, sometimes we can use a concrete number to describe it, but in this case, it is hard to use concrete number to describe its order of growth, n log n, n log n. Yeah. So that means there is something hidden, something a little vague, when we talk about this concept. Yeah. All right. But we frequently, we use this concept to do comparisons. We say the first function. All right. The first function has smaller order of growth than the second function. Then we mean the first function increases slower than the second function. Yeah, all right. So let me get back to the previous question another time. Cormac, another time. Yeah, because here it's pretty abstract. So the explanation clearly is very important here. Yeah, all right. But this time, I try to use relatively simple examples to do comparison. One is n squared, another is n cubed. All right, the first function n squared, the second function n cubed. Then if we take the limit of these two functions, when n goes to infinity, it equals zero, right? Yeah, it matches the case we are considering. And then if we look at the order of growth, the first one, two, second one, three. So it is very easy to see two less than three. Or we just say the order of growth of the first function is less than the order of growth of the second function. Yeah, so from this example, we can see our conclusion easily. But here, I use the simple case, the exponent n. Yeah. So here we use the power function, right? We use the power functions. When we use the power functions, then we just compare the exponents, or we treat the exponents as the order of growth. That's pretty simple, right? Power function. The order of growth corresponds to the exponent number. But for non-power function, this one, n log n, it's not a power function, right? The log n part, we cannot use any power function to describe log n function. In that case, it is hard to use some specific number to describe its order of growth. Yeah. All right, so let me go to the next case, case number two. This time, the limit of the ratio is a positive constant. Yeah, so for our situation, we have the positive constant case. Yeah. In that case, we say order of growth f of n equals order of growth g of n. Can you understand this step? Yeah. The ratio is a positive constant. That c could be 1 million. Yeah. Think about the c could be. So here, I really like you to understand this case number two, because let's consider two extremal cases. Now, a positive constant. Can we make C positive constant 0.0001? Can we make positive constant C 1 million? Right? If you look at these two numbers, their difference is pretty big, right? But look at our conclusion. Number two, no matter C equals 0.001 or C equals 1 million, the conclusion is the same. That is, the order of growth of F of n equals order of growth of G of n. Can you understand this? Do you feel comfortable understand this conclusion? You may feel, because based on intuition, you may feel it's not fair, right? Why C equals 0.1 and C equals 1 million, we treat them have the same order. Why, right? So if you have that kind of understanding issue, think about that, okay? All right. To make that clearly, let's look at these two functions, 0.0001 n squared, all right? We put a coefficient with that power function, all right? Yeah, and 1 million n squared, all right? Look at that. Only the difference is, only the coefficients are different. Other than the coefficients, the variable part, n squared, the variable part, exactly the same. Then we say these two functions have the same order of growth. Can you get, you know, do you feel comfortable with this conclusion? We know their absolute values are quite different, right? Absolute values are quite different. But, so here, let me go back to one concept we learned last time, called it rate of change. How about that? Rate of change. All right, okay. Now, here, f of n equals the first function, g of n equals second function. All right. Although they have quite different coefficient part, but when we consider how fast is the increasing rate for each function, when n goes to infinity, and when we double the problem size m. Remember, so last time we looked at this, f of 2n of f of n. All right. The second one, the rate, when we double the function, the problem size, then we look at their corresponding, ratio of their corresponding functions, what do you get? Right? You get they are the same, right? Rate of change here for these two functions are the same because the positive constant, although they are so different, but both are canceled out, right? Yeah. The first ratio, that 0.001 cancel out. The second ratio, that 1 million also cancel out. So the rate of the change exactly the same. If they have the same rate of change or increasing rate, yeah, because rate of change probably a little confusing because in calculus we use this to describe derivative, right? Yeah. So let's call increasing rate. Yeah, actually the full name should be the increasing the rate when we double the problem size. Yeah, the complete sentence should be the increasing rate when the problem size is double. All right, that concept. All right, yeah, because this rate of change, that corresponds to derivative. So we should not get that confused. All right, yeah. So here, caution here. All right. All right, so then we say they have the same order of growth for case number two. All right, so case number three, this time infinity, right? Yes, the ratio approaches to the infinity. That means we just switch these two cases, right? We put n cubed at the numerator, n squared at the denominator, like that. Yeah. So you can see just opposite of case number one. Think about that, opposite of case number one. Okay, yeah. So that means the order of growth of f of n is greater than order of growth of g of n. All right, so that's the first three cases. But for the last case, then we have a lot of discussion because the limit does not exist. We need to consider this special case. Because the function, the limit f of n over g of n, it is not guaranteed that the limit always exists, right? When you learn calculus, limit does not exist. It could happen sometimes, right? Yeah. But here, you may ask me to give you an example, show you a simple example why the limit does not exist, right? Yeah. So here, let me give you a simple example here. All right. Let us consider the ratio of these two functions, all right? The first one, okay? Yeah. So let me write 4 plus negative 1 to the nth power times n squared, all right? The second one, the coefficient, let me write 3 minus negative 1 to the n, n squared. For this example, when we consider the limit when n goes to infinity, do you have any cases in top 3 you can find that this one could be equal to? Definitely not 0, right? Second, not non-positive constant, non-zero constant. Case number 2, it's not, right? Yeah. Why it's not? Yes. Some students may like to ask me why it's not. Yeah, because n squared can be canceled out. Then we just look at the, you know, fraction sequence. Yeah. When n equals 0, let's see, when n equals 0, so 4 plus 1 over 3 minus 1. What's that? That's 5 over 2, right? When n equals 1, yeah, 4 minus 1, that's 3. And 1, 3 plus 1, 4, 3 fourths. All right? Next one, 5 seconds, 3 fourths. Changing alternatively. How about that? This sequence, can you say there is a limit? No limit, right? Yeah. Switching between 2 numbers, fluctuation, up and down, up, down, up, down, fluctuation, and never converges, right? This sequence does not converge. So that's the reason the limit does not exist, right? Yeah. So that means case number 4, we need to do some serious discussion because we cannot find its limit. The limit does not exist. All right, yeah. Okay, so here we, yeah, at this point, after we did this discussion, here we need some compact notation. Yeah. So why compact notation? Yeah. Because look at the first 3 cases. For the first 3 cases, if you want to describe it, you need to say many words, right? Order of growth of f of n is less than order of growth of g of n. That's not efficient, right? Because in our computation, we like to use concise notations without using too many words. Yeah. So here we use some compact notations. The first case, we use little o notation. Little o notation. So we just write f of n function belongs to little o of g of n. What is little o? Yeah, all right, so here, let me describe this little o. Little o means a set of function. Yeah, a set of function related to g of n. Yeah, little of g of n, all right. So a set of functions based on g of n. So what, based on, in what sense? Based in what sense, right? The sense is the limit of f of n over g of n when n goes to infinity equals 0, just our case 1. Just our case 1. Yeah. So specifically, this notation means exactly, so you can translate into this expression equals 0, this expression. Okay, yeah. All right. That's the first case. Second case, we use another symbol, notation, big theta. F of n belongs to big theta of g of n. Here we use the big theta, we represent f function and a g function, they have the same order of growth. Same order of growth, a big theta. Yeah. In this way, we can write a relatively compact expression. We do not say that many words. Yeah. All right. Then the third case, greater than, this time we write little omega. Okay, yeah, order of growth. The limit of those two functions equals infinity. So this time we use little omega. All right, yeah. So these three symbols correspond to three different asymptotic notations. And we have a few more. Yeah, we have a few more. Yeah. And next slide, I will give you definitions. I will, next few slides, I will give you, rigorous definitions for asymptotic notations. Yeah. Pretty abstract, not easy to understand. Yeah. And we will spend quite some time to understand these abstract notations, concepts. Yeah. All right, next. Back to case number four. We want to study case number four. So we don't want to, ignore case number four. All right, yeah. So the limit way has some limitation. The limit way cannot be used here. It does not mean there is no other effective way that we can use to study case number four. It does not mean that. We need to find a different way to study case number four. Okay, yeah. So we need to find a new method for case number four. So in our next slide, so let's look at a new method using upper bounds and the lower bounds to study case number four. Yeah. Okay. Objective. Yeah. So here we assume the limit of f of n over g of n, where n goes to infinity, does not exist. But we want to compare these two growth functions in some special way. Yeah. How to do it? Yeah. All right. Because in our algorithm context, when we use asymptotic notations, yeah, something like what we learned, the three asymptotic notation, little of g of n, big theta of g of n, little omega of g of n. Yeah. So here you can see we put inside parentheses g of n. And usually we like to put simple functions like n squared, n log n. Yeah. Because using relatively simple functions, we can get idea on the order of growth easily, right? When you look at the order of growth of n, is it easy? When you look at the order of growth of n squared, is it easy? Also, n log n, also very easy, right? So that's the reason usually we take g function, relatively simple functions like these functions we put here. All right. So then for the f of function could be a complex function. Yeah. The function at a numerator could be relatively more complex function. Yeah. All right. Then here, how do we use g function to describe f function? Yeah. So this point here, use some constant multiples of g function to approximate f function. Constant multiples to approximate. Okay, make it as close as possible to describe f function. Yeah. All right. How to do it? So specifically, can we find two positive constants, C1 and C2, such that we have this inequality? C2 times g of n less than or equal to f of n and less than or equal to C1 g of n. Can we find two positive constants with this inequality? That is, we use multiple of g function as two bounds, one lower bound, another upper bound. This kind of approximation. Yeah. That's the way to use to replace the limit way. Limit way does not work, right? So we change to a different way. Now we use inequality way to replace the limit way. Here, think about, even if the limit does not exist, it is still possible we can find a C1, C2 to get this kind of inequality, right? Yes. So if you look at the previous example that I use to show you the limit does not exist, numerator 4 plus parenthesis negative 1 to the nth power times n squared, denominator function parenthesis 3 minus negative 1 to the nth parenthesis n squared. If you look at that, we can find this kind of inequality easily, right? Yeah, look at that. So here I do not write it explicitly. So you can imagine for our previous example, the limit does not exist, but there is this kind of upper bound, lower bound inequality available we can use to describe f function in this way. Yeah. So based on this analysis, then our case number 4, we have a new method to study case number 4. So that is finding upper bounds, lower bounds, and get some appropriate inequality for the description. How about that? All right. So that is what we, you know, make some progress when we study the order of growth. All right. This method works no matter the limit of the ratio of these two functions exists or not. If it exists, we can still use this method, right? Yeah. Even if it exists, if you like, you can still use this method, inequality method, right? Yes. So in other words, when the limit exists, you have two methods, right? The first one, the limit method. The second one, the inequality method. All right, yeah, the inequality method, two methods, okay, yeah. So you just pick one so that you feel relatively easy. Yeah. But usually if the limit exists, usually the limit weight is easier. The limit weight is easier than the inequality weight, usually. Okay, yeah. All right. So now we complete our topic C.1. Yeah. Any question? Yeah. A little abstract. A little abstract. Yeah. But we have to go through it because this is the critical part of algorithm analysis. We have to go through, and later from now on, we will use asymptotic notations when we describe our algorithms. Yeah. So that's why this part is very important. All right. Part C.2, define asymptotic notations. So this time, I need to give you rigorous definitions. Yeah. I hope it's not too hard for you. Yeah. All right. Let's start. The first one, rigorous definition. Another asymptotic notation, it's called a big O notation. Yeah. Different from the first three we learned in C.1. So here we will learn another three. Okay, another three in this C.2. Yeah. Big O notation, the definition. Yeah. Let's look at the definition carefully. For a given function g of n, the notation big O of g of n represents the set of function f of n that satisfy the following condition. What is that condition? Yeah. There exists some positive constant c. There exists some positive constant c and some two constant. That's why no s. All right. I just look at the c part. But here we are talking about two, not one, all right? Yeah, two constant. One is positive c, another is non-negative integer and zero. So that's why, yeah, no s. Yeah. Such that, all right, f of n less than or equal to c times g of n for all n greater or equal to n zero. That's the definition. That's the complete, rigorous meaning of this big O notation. Yeah. But here I need to explain as some relatively hard parts. All right. First, let's look at this n zero. N zero, non-negative integer n zero. Okay. Yeah. Because for some of you, you may feel, what is the role of this n zero, right? What is the role of n zero? Yeah. So here, let me explain the role here. Yeah. It is important. This n zero, it is important. We cannot ignore it. Yeah. Look at this. Think about, look at this inequality. Yeah. All right. Look at this inequality. In the real world situation, this inequality may not always exist, may not always true. Yeah, let me say it this way, may not be always true. Sometimes true, sometimes false. It could be like that. All right. And typically, when we study algorithm, typically, at early stage, this inequality is not true. But when n becomes larger and larger, after n, is greater than some specific number, then the inequality becomes true. And from there, it is always true. That's the typical situation we have when we do the algorithm analysis. For that reason, we need to use this N0 to tell us after which point then this inequality becomes true. Okay? Before this point, so we don't worry. Yeah. So we do not care if it's true or not. It doesn't matter. It's not important. Okay? Before this N point, if the inequality holds or not, it's not important. All right? Yeah. So that's the meaning here. But you may ask why not important, right? Yeah. So here, let me put this question. Okay. Let me put this question. Why it is not important? When n less than n zero for some constant. Remember, this must be constant. All right, yeah. Constant, that means after you select it, it must be fixed. It must be fixed. You only have one chance to select it. All right, before you select it, you have freedom. So here we understand this way, this N0, before you make your selection, you have freedom to select it. You can make it 100, 1 million, or even 1 billion is okay, okay? You can make it very large if you like, all right? But you only have one chance. After you select it, you can never change it. It must be fixed. All right, yeah, so that's the property of this N0. Yeah. Then we can ask this question, why it is not important when it is important if the inequality exists or not? I'm talking about that. It means what? That inequality exists or not. That fact is not important, all right? That fact is not important when n less than that n zero number, okay? All right. So for this question, let me delay it a little bit, yeah, because I have too many things to explain today. So, but this question is important for us. This question is important for us. So I will find some time later, I go come back to explain this question, all right, to help us understand this concept better. Yeah. All right, so I put it here, all right, yeah, temporarily, yeah. So that is the N0 thing, yeah. Then we say for all N greater or equal to zero, after you choose N0, then the inequality always true when n greater or equal to n zero. Okay, yeah. And sometimes people also use another way to represent this meaning, that is when n is sufficiently large. Okay, when n is sufficiently large, that means, you know, there exists this condition and, you know, that part, yeah. All right, let me say in this way, okay? Yeah, because sometimes people say this word, when n is sufficiently large, then many people, they may have doubt that, because sufficiently large, this is a subjective description, right? Subjective description, right? Not objective, subjective description. Not objective description, right? How large is sufficiently large? Nobody can say it clearly, right? That nobody knows how large is sufficiently large. All right. So here, my answer to this question is, in our algorithm context, yeah, first I need to put this in our algorithm context. In other contexts, then I cannot use this explanation. Yeah. All right. So in the algorithm context, the sufficiently large, that phrase, it means exactly the condition and this part. Yeah, let me repeat the whole sentence. There exists some positive constant C. Yeah, actually not the C part, all right? Sufficiently large means the N zero part. There exists some non-negative integer N zero. So then for all N greater or equal to N zero, some property holds. All right, that condition related to the N zero part, that part, we can say N sufficiently large. All right. Yeah, because so here it is a little bit confusing, a little bit confusing. Yeah. So let me make it a little better for sufficiently large here. The wording, yeah, mainly the wording. Yeah. Actually, it's a pretty popular wording. So I need to explain it clearly. Yeah. Let me restate the above sentence using the sufficiently large term phrase to repeat that condition again. All right, let me say it this way. All right, condition, only the condition part, okay? Following condition. There exists, this time I use S, there exists, because I only talk about C constant. I do not talk about N zero. All right, yeah. So I say there, yeah, let me write it down, okay? Yeah, because it's not a long sentence. I write it alternative way, all right? Yeah, all right. Alternative way. I forgot spelling, all right. All right, so let me just write the alternative statement. There exists some positive constant. C, all right, yeah. Yeah. Alternative way. All right. Positive constant C, such that I do not talk about N zero. F of N less than or equal to C times G of N when N is sufficiently large. These two statements are equivalent. Okay? First one, second one, equivalent. The second one, we skip that N zero. Although we skip, actually we make that N zero implicit, all right? So we avoid it. We make N zero implicit. You cannot see it, but if you want to understand what do you mean N is sufficiently large, then you need to go back to use that N zero. Someone can find a non-negative integer N zero, such that for or n greater or equal to n zero, that condition is true. All right, so that's the meaning, complete meaning, okay, of this definition. Yeah, because this is our first definition of the asymptotic notation, so I use a little more time to do explanation. Next, we have two more, then I do not need to spend that much time, right? Because similar, the understanding is quite similar. Only difference is that inequality part is different. Yeah, we just adapt to, you know, different inequalities. Yeah, adapt this definition to other two definitions for those different inequalities. Yeah. All right. Oh yeah, sorry, I have to erase my writing here because I need to show a picture. Yeah. That's not good. Yeah. If you can take notes, you can write it down. Yeah. Yeah. Otherwise, yeah, I need to erase my writing here. All right. So then, because later in my annotation file, you won't see this part. Yeah, but only you can see that in the video. All right. Okay. Yeah, because I want to show you a graph for this one. All right. We have f of n function, the curve below. Yeah, the curve lower, the lower one. All right. Then C multiple G, C times G of M, that is the upper function. All right. Upper function above that, this F function, but there is a vertical dashed line here, this line, position at N zero. Yeah. After that line, then C times G, the curve, the graph of the curve is above the graph of F function. But before that dashed line, doesn't matter. Look at that, doesn't matter. All right? Above or below, it's not important. It doesn't matter. Why doesn't matter? So that's the question I left before. Now, later I will explain that. Yeah. Yeah. Why? And it makes sense. It doesn't matter. All right. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So that is the first definition, big O notation. Yeah. Second one, big omega notation. All right. So this time, yeah, the statement pretty much similar. So here you can see we use the same sentence. We only change from big O to big omega. All right. Then the condition. Yeah, this part also the same, right? Yeah. And inequality is different. Yeah, this is the main difference. This time, we use C times G of N as the lower bound. The previous case, we have both upper bound and the lower bound. This time we only have lower bound. There is no upper bound in the form of multiple of G function. No such upper bound. For this case, we call it big omega. We call it F of N belongs to big omega of G of N. Okay, yeah. In this case, yeah, we can write F of N belongs to big omega of G of N. Okay, yeah. All right. Then the graph is like this. This time, C times G of N as the lower bound. Its curve below the curve of f of n after some vertical line, okay? N zero, vertical line, yeah. So that is the our second asymptotic notation, all right. The third one, yeah, big theta notation, big theta, all right, yeah. So the big theta notation, and this time, most parts similar, okay? Oh, sorry. Oh, just a minute. I think I make something wrong. Yeah, all right, it's, yeah, because C1, C2, that's big theta. When we talk about big O, yeah, big O, actually we only have upper bound, we don't have lower bound, yeah. All right, I have to go back, all right. Yeah, that's pretty bad. All right, because let's go back a few slides. All right, here. All right, look at that. Here you can see only upper bound, right? C, G, there is no lower bound. All right. Oh, yeah. Oh, good, good. Yeah, I'm not wrong. It's okay. Only upper bound, no lower bound. Okay, I'm okay. I got confused. I thought I have both upper bound, lower bound. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. We only have upper bound. All right. So big O, we only have upper bound. Big omega, we only have lower bound, right? Then big theta, we have both upper bound and a lower bound. Yeah, all right. So then the remaining, the description, almost the same. Yeah. Only that upper bound, lower bound, that inequality, that part different. Then we change to different asymptotic notations. Yeah. Here you can see both upper bound in the graph, lower bound. So you can see if you have both upper bound and a lower bound, you can approximate that function better, f function better from both sides, right? So you can see this big theta description of that f function gives us more information than the other two cases, big O and big omega. Because the other two cases, just a one side description, right? Upper or lower, only one side description. Here we have both sides description. Yeah. So this one gives us more information. Yeah. All right. So now we complete C.2 and the last one, C.3, example of asymptotic notations. I do a few examples. Yeah. So let me try. Because the first few examples relatively easy. So let me see how many I can do today. Yeah. We only have less than 10 minutes. Yeah. Let me try. The first one is pretty simple. Yeah. The first one, show that n plus 2 belongs to big theta of n. Yeah. When you solve this problem, big theta, you have two methods, right? Based on our discussion before, you have two methods. Yeah. Method one, limit way, right? Method two, inequality way. Right, yeah. Limit way, is it easy? Look at that. Look at this limit. N over two, n plus two over n, what is this limit? Okay, it's easy, right? Yeah, it's one, right? Is it non-zero constant? Yeah. If it is non-zero constant, based on our definition before, or based on our early description, remember our limit description in C.1, based on that, we have the conclusion. N plus two belongs to big theta of n. Okay, yeah. But here, what I show you the second method, inequality way. In order to use the inequality way, we consider our n plus two function, but we need to find both upper bound and the lower bound in the form of multiple of n. You need to find constant C1, C2, positive constant C1, C2 that can be used as both the lower bound and upper bound for n plus two. Yeah. What is the lower bound first? N multiple of n as the lower bound. You have freedom to choose that C2 positive constant. C2 just one, n less than n plus two, right? N is a constant multiple of n, right? Yeah, and for n zero, your n zero, you can choose zero. When n greater or equal to zero, that inequality holds. Although when n negative, it holds, right? But remember, in our algorithm context, our problem size cannot be negative, right? Our problem size could be zero. We allow our problem size to be zero, but it does not make sense. The problem size is a negative number. So that's the reason we do not consider negative case. Yeah. So n zero equals zero and the C2 equals one. So that's the lower bound. What is the upper bound? A different constant multiple of n that we can use above, or its curve, its graph above that of n plus two. Think about that, okay? All right, we do this way. We replace two by n, okay? When we replace two by n, n plus n, that's a constant multiple of n, right? 2n, yeah. But when we replace two by n, we want to get an upper bound. We require that n greater or equal to two. Otherwise, you cannot get upper bound, right? Yeah, because if n not greater or equal to two, you do not get an upper bound. So that's why we need that condition, n greater or equal to two condition. That's the reason we need that n zero number. Okay, you can see we use it here, okay? When n greater or equal to two, we have the upper bound 2n. How about that? So that means C1 equals two. So we find C1 constant, C2 constant, and n zero, what is n zero, right? So here, the first time our n zero can take zero, the second time our n zero takes two, but overall, you need to give me one constant that could be used for both cases. That is n zero equals two. Because n zero equals two, we can use it for the first case. First case, we only need n greater or equal to zero, it is true, but then n greater or equal to two, it is also true, right? Yes. If the first inequality is true for n greater or equal to zero, it must be also true for n greater or equal to two. Right, yeah, so that's the reason our third constant n zero equals two. So we find these three constant, okay, yeah. So that means for method number two, inequality method, in order to do it, you need to find three constant. What three C1, C2, and N0. Then you complete the solution. Okay. Then you complete the solution. All right. That's our first example. Second example. Yeah. That's our last example today. Yeah. All right. This time we need to show N cube belongs to big omega of N squared. Big omega, by its definition, we need to use the lower bound to describe, approximate original function, right? Yeah. Although some students may feel or may ask me, is it possible we can use infinity way to answer this question? Yes. Infinity also, not infinity, a limit way. Limit and infinity, limit equals infinity, right? Yeah. So if you like, you can use the limit way, n cubed over n squared equals n goes to infinity after simplification, just n equals infinity. Then you have the conclusion, right? The limit way also pretty simple, yeah, because we can easily get that the ratio of the two functions, its limit equals infinity. So we have the conclusion. Yeah. But here we use the second method, inequality way. And this time also pretty easy, right? N cubed greater or equal to n squared when n greater or equal to zero. Remember our n always integers, right? N greater than zero, we do not consider n equals 1/2, right? 0.3 things, you know, that could not be our n, right? Yeah, because n only integers. Okay, yeah, only. So this condition, good enough, okay? So in this way, we find C constant equals one, and n zero constant equals zero. So this case, we only need to find two constant, not three constant. Big theta, we need a three constant. Big omega, we need a two constant. Big O, we also need two constant. Okay, all right, yeah. Okay, so that's our example number two, yeah. I have two more examples I will leave to the next time. So today, our main part mainly introduced the asymptotic notations. Yeah. Relatively hard, yeah, but we have to get a good understanding on this concept. All right, so that's pretty much I like to cover today.